Coming up on LATiNAS, we celebrate Women's History Month and learn about Bisila Bokoko, talk about reproductive rights, and so much more. LATiNAS starts now. Welcome to LATiNAS, the show that's all about nosotras. I'm Tinabeth Piña. March is Women's History Month, and we're here at the Whitney Museum of American Art in Lower Manhattan, where there's a landmark exhibition using Hurricane Maria as a metaphor for the political, economic, and natural disasters that are currently occurring in Puerto Rico. The exhibit, which features mostly female artists, is called No Existe Un Mundo Post Huracán, Puerto Rican Art in the Wake of Hurricane Maria. Correspondent Judith Escalona has that story.
Nadie nos enseña a aceptar la muerte.
It was important for me to include Spanish in every facet of the exhibition. The title of the exhibition, No Existe Un Mundo Post Huracán, it's important to know that it's a verse that comes from a book of poems by Raquel Salas Rivera. And the verse itself is one of the artworks in the show.
For Marcela Guerrero, senior curator at the Whitney Museum of American Art, including Spanish in the show's title and labels was a way for the museum to open its doors to new visitors while expanding the idea of American art for the general public.
I always think that it's important, especially for a museum of American art, to reflect in its, I call it the language scape of the museum, to reflect what's right outside of our steps.
Since 2018, the Whitney has labeled all its exhibitions in English and Spanish, a welcoming gesture to the local and international Latino communities.
Obviously, I want Puerto Ricans from the archipelago of Puerto Rico and from the diaspora to come and feel pride on what they see and how Puerto Rico is represented through the artworks and the labels. That's key, that's number one.
I came for this show specifically. Because I was riveted by what was going on in Puerto Rico, and I have family there.
Guerrero also expects international and U.S. visitors who typically frequent the museum to also gain from experiencing the artwork.
I think those people might remember that a couple of years ago, Puerto Rico had a devastating hurricane. I want those people to come see the exhibition and to read through the labels and understand the complexity of living in Puerto Rico, which is essentially a colony.
It's something that I know, obviously, the American, or maybe the international narrative on, but not necessarily the Puerto Rican or the local narrative on, so I find it very interesting. And I didn't know about all the protests, so yeah, very illuminating.
For another visitor, No Existe resonates artistically and politically.
Creo que es una muy buena oportunidad de ver arte de Puerto Rico que piensa críticamente sobre el vínculo con Estados Unidos y cómo eso ha impactado para la identidad de Puerto Rico. Y creo que este tipo de trabajos que traen objetos producto de la devastación, de la destrucción del territorio al espacio público hace reflexionar mucho sobre eso.
Hurricane Maria that decimated Puerto Rico serves as a metaphor for an obsolete colonial condition that continues to fail its citizens. The survey of Puerto Rican art focuses on the year the storm made landfall in 2017 through an ongoing problematic recovery in 2022. It features 20 artists from the archipelago and its diaspora.
The majority, I would say, are women and non-binary and trans artists. I was looking at the makeup of the artists, and I wanted to make sure that we had a little bit of more representation from the island because it was those artists who felt the hurricane.
Including artists of the diaspora was a way of recognizing the bond between the peoples of the archipelago and those who migrated stateside to the U.S.
It was a diaspora who sent money, who sent donations, who sent food, equipment, and even knowledge, especially people who had been here for Sandy.
The landmark exhibition, the first by a major U.S. museum in 50 years, also points to a watershed moment in Puerto Rican history.
The hurricane wasn't the problem. You know, we know that Taínos knew what to expect every hurricane season and they prepared for it. It's that overlapping situation when a hurricane collides with our colonial status.
Can art and politics mix in positive ways? Can artists provide a pathway to self-determination for Puerto Rico? Only time will tell. I'm Judith Escalona at the Whitney Museum of American Art for LATiNAS.
Bisila Bokoko is considered one of the 10 most influential Spanish women in American business. She's not only the former director of Spain's U.S. Chamber of Commerce in New York, but she's also the founder of an African literacy project, which has already opened libraries in Africa and the Dominican Republic. We're about to find out why she's today's Inspiración Latina.
I was born in Valencia in the 70s, where there was no black people in Spain, and I was the only one. Both of my parents coming from Equatorial Guinea, it's a very tiny country, and they moved to Spain. And I remember exactly the first time that I realized I was black. It was because the teacher sit me down next to a boy, and this boy started crying. And he said, no, I don't want to sit down with her because I will be black like her. So he thought that it was contagious. And I went home and I told my parents, this is what happened. And my father said, you know what? You are black and you're a woman. And with that, you will have to deal in your life. And I think that shaped, of course, my way of living, because being the unique person in any room, I think it also gave me a sense of responsibility. If you are the first generation of Africans born here, if your behavior is not outstanding, you will affect people who come in after you. My work in Africa and books is very interesting because I never thought that I would have any philanthropic interest. Being an immigrant and your parents always telling you, you better make money, I had this message so integrated in me that I never thought that solidarity could be the best business. And I remember when I met the chief of Cocofu, which is like a king in a little place, he said, I want you to be the queen of development of this town. And I said, oh my God, yes, I want to be a queen. I got the honor the first time I go to Africa, it just hit the jackpot. So I said, yes, when, how? And he said, do you want to do it right now? And I said, no, wait. If I'm going to be a queen, I need people who come with me. He said, this is for you to really take the decision. I give you a piece of land, and with that piece of land, you could do anything. This is your home, and this is who we want you to come in here and develop with us. Then I wonder, okay, maybe if these children can read about the world, they will also open up their minds to it. So this project started in 2010, and we created the first library in Kofu, and we saw what happened. I remember that the children always ask me, oh, we want traveling books. We want to travel because they want to travel with their minds. And I have a little library in Kenya, in Masai Mara. And they came from having only a tree to be the school. They don't even have a board to write, nothing. And I give them books for them to dream. And I give them books of the wine dyer, for example, Real Magic. I give them The Secret, I give them all these books for them to realize that they could change their lives if they really imagine that. And I went there with groups of friends to inspire them and people who came from US or people who came from Europe, and they spent time with these children. And I remember one of my girls that I love, she had learning disabilities and how to be connected with books and my support, she could really, you know, change her life, and she graduated recently from university. And when I came to New York, I also realized, okay, I don't have the education here. And actually, I met somebody from Ghana at the Graduate Center, Professor Kojo, and he was making a presentation about a program about international relations, and I thought, wow, this is so cool. So I went to the City College, and I was in the CUNY system to study international relations, and that also shaped my life. Because I came to study law and economics, but to have this wide vision of what is the world really make me understand humans in a different way. So I think I integrated that education. And in that program in the CUNY was a very interesting one. And we realized that when you put the ladder for other women, Latina women, to move up, you are helping so many women.
We've heard the debates about abortion and reproductive rights. But have you heard those arguments from a spiritual perspective? Three Latinas, a bishop, a curandera, and a pregnancy advocate, are about to take on that fiery issue in today's Caliente Caliente.
Pre-abortion, pro-abortion, no abortion, You know, everything requires a healing, because person, before they even decide to or not to, there's got to be a healing process inside, mentally and emotionally. Speaking in my role as a minister, the Talmud or the Quran or even the Bible doesn't even have the word abortion in it. And in the Old Testament, if a woman's life was at risk, it was considered okay, according to them, to be able to not have the child. I'm pro-life. I think abortion and, you know, killing a child is not right. But taking away a woman's decision-making on that, I find that that's not right.
You are a person of faith. You believe in God, but... And the moment that we... It's like me saying, I love you, but... Why do I have the but there? Like, what is going on? You know, for me, it's tough to hear that, to hear I believe in God and I am for abortion. As a sidewalk counselor, this is what I do with them. Being with them from the moment that I know that they're pregnant, that I meet them outside of the abortion clinic, from that moment on, hearing their story, loving on them, saying, I know I don't know you, but I care for you. For them to come to the abortion clinic, to really have had made this appointment, for them to really have even asked for forgiveness the night before, they tell me, I already asked God for forgiveness because of what I'm about to do. They know deep down inside the hurt.
Yes.
They already know that there's life inside of them. No. But then they want to ask for forgiveness, not because they're not just ready for this pregnancy. It's inconvenient. And then I tell them, okay, so let's talk about it. What can we do for you? Let's see what is the pregnancy center in the area that can really, you know, walk with you as well. Like, it's a team.
There really is no right, wrong, or way. For me, I feel that the right way is to empower people. Mm-hmm. So empowering people through, you know, education around their sexuality, empowering people around having even good health care, like... So many abortions wouldn't even go down if women had more access, you know, to safe spaces. So how do we empower a woman's body? How do we empower her voice to say, hey, we need to use protection, or, you know, this isn't for me, whether in the heat of the moment or whether you are faced with unwanted pregnancy, right? Because that would be the reason why a woman would have an abortion. It's not desired in her life at that time. Specifically, my work has centered around sacred sexuality and intimacy practices, bringing more conscious awareness to how we interact with one another, how we're healing, how we relate, right? Because we've all grown over the generations, how men and women interact. Since the beginning of time, women have been so much so seen as a commodity, property. There's so many things that women have had to overcome in order just to exist.
My concern, in addition to, yes, fear, is that there'll be more suicides. Yes. There'll be more back alley illegal abortions. So we think that it's just children or youth or young adults or teenagers that get affected. But no, married women, unmarried women. You know, are we going to go back to the 1800s where even contraceptives were banned?
I've talked to women that have 4 kids and now they're pregnant. And it's like, wow, am I going to go deeper into poverty here? I'm already not living in an ideal situation. We can tell young women like, oh, you're going to be fine and your people are going to surround you. But then also we live in a time where we're not living in tribal communities. We don't have all of the titis and the people coming over to help and like the other men supporting and guarding. We don't have those structures. So it's a little imbalanced, and the word that's coming is like a little delusional to just give women this idea when that really might not be the reality of the situation.
We are not who decides when a life should end, right? Whether it's because we feel that, it's not a convenient time for me right now. I'm just not ready for this. I don't have the right people around me or whatever that may be. Again, that's why we have these pregnancy resource centers. We have sidewalk counselors. We have people. If we search it up, there's all these amazing organizations like Live Action, Let Them Live, the one that I'm with as well, Life Advocates of New Jersey, which when women reach out, we are caring for them every step of the way. I've been there for the birth of three of my moms, so it has been 10 babies that I've been able to help, I've been able to help save.
Yeah. We have to look at, there's infant mortality.
Yeah.
That's, it's very high, especially for Black women. There's infanticide, women that end up having their babies because they don't know what else to do. They were afraid to have an abortion. And then what happens? They end up drowning their babies or killing their babies. The health disparities in this country are not, they're horrible. There are many states that you have free health care for women. And then you have a woman that's pregnant, many times they can't get proper health care. They can't get neonatal care. And they end up having a child who end up sick in the hospital, and it takes them into bills. So there's a lot of decision making, not just on the faith factor and the fact that, yes, life is sacred.
It
Everyone's
is.
Life is sacred. Is. The woman's life, the child's life is very sacred. However, what I'm saying is we can't take away the decision making of a woman. We shouldn't take it away.
Yes. Hear more from these Latinas next month when it comes to a woman's right to choose and if men should have a voice in that conversation. Stay tuned.
You may have seen this famous picture of Rosie the Riveter, an iconic image of female empowerment that was created during World War II that endures today. Rosie was the star of the campaign to recruit female workers as men continued to enlist in the war. Women entered the workforce in never-before-seen numbers to offset the labor shortage. Many of these women who took on these challenging jobs were Latina, and despite facing language barriers or discrimination, Latina Rosies played an integral role in supporting the military and earned their place in U.S. history as heroes of the war effort. The image continues to be recreated by many today.
Can you believe that hip-hop has been around for 50 years? And its style, which reflected streetwear that Black and Latino kids wore in the 70s, has undeniably become a global phenomenon. Correspondent Elena Romero is about to explore from the Latino lens an exhibit at the museum at FIT that she co-curated that examines the evolution of hip-hop style and its influence on the fashion industry.
If I walk through the story of hip-hop, Latinos have played a part from the beginning.
Afro-Latina fashion designer April Walker of the iconic Walkerwear brand saw hip-hop as a new mode of expression in the 1970s.
I think hip-hop was a universal language, a universal culture, and it was a way to express ourselves. We weren't being seen or heard when it came to the media, and I feel like hip-hop became our amplifier.
Not only was it amplifying the sounds of Black and brown youth, but it birthed a global fashion style that moved from the streets to the runway and red carpet.
The role that fashion played in hip-hop was our uniforms. It was, this is who we are, this is how we express ourselves. We do it a little differently.
How so?
I remember in the 70s growing up, seeing people that would buy jeans and they would bleach them out, they would cut them up, they would paint on them. I remember always seeing people buying things and then doing their own remixes, their own edits. So for us, I wanted that. What wasn't seen, what wasn't being felt, I wanted us to have our own uniforms. And we didn't have anything like that in the stores that we could go and buy that spoke to us.
Walker is among the Latino pioneering designers who blazed the streetwear trail. Alongside Panamanian and Costa Rican streetwear designer Carl Kanai, and later, Boricua Willie Montañez Escobar, better known as Willie Esco. All three designers have their fashions on display at the museum at FIT in an exhibition entitled Fresh, Fly, Fabulous, 50 Years of Hip Hop Style.
We often don't get the praise because the visual is black and white. Celebrating 50 years of hip hop, FIT, my alma mater, is showcasing the lineage, which when I was going here didn't exist. It was nothing. It was just two brands.
On display, patrons can see Esco's leather jacket, a sports jersey, and a low-life shirt he designed, while Walker's custom Afro-denim jacket and a denim shirt from the 1990s are in the exhibit, as well as more recent items like her Walker-wear earrings.
We were all in those clubs, all in those streets. We were the customer we were serving, so that helped us. And it wasn't there yet, so we weren't afraid to just do and be and express. And I think that's what it made it authentic.
Designer Willie Esco sees the future bright for both Latinos in hip hop and fashion.
But I think Bad Bunny is a great example how it will be done, and the new dynamics of fashion will change under his tutelage.
We're in 2023, right? And we can name a few, but not enough. It's not going fast enough for me. So I'm sure there are a lot of Latin designers out there that are trying to break in those doors, but the doors should be open for them.
For Latinas, I'm Elena Romero.
March is also Disability Awareness Month, and Dominicana Johileny Meran is paving the way for others with disabilities to travel the globe. And that's why she's today's Latina on the Rise.
I work at a nonprofit organization called Mobility International USA. And what they do really is advance the leadership of people with disabilities through international development and international exchange.
Dominicana Johileny Meran, who has cerebral palsy, never thought she would have a career in international exchange or even study abroad when she was in college.
I would go to these like information sessions on study abroad, and I would learn about what it meant like to be a person of color going abroad, what it meant like to be a low-income student going abroad. And then at the end of those sessions, I would always ask, okay, well, I have a disability. What is that going to be like for me going abroad? And the only answer I ever got was, you can go to the Office of Students with Disabilities. But the Office of Students with Disabilities would tell me, oh, you can go to the Study Abroad office. They'll tell you, they're experts in that. So it became like a bouncing ball of trying to figure out information.
And what Johileny does now is provide students like herself with the very information she needed so many years ago.
So as a Latina, why is this important to you?
I think as a Latina, it's important for our immigrant families to understand that the world is so much bigger and holds so much connection and opportunity for us. Understanding that type of background and, you know, the struggles of like trying to explain to your parents why it's so important to travel, when it's like, no, you can do that here. We've already traveled to the States. Why do you want to go somewhere else? Because it's important.
When Johileny studied abroad in London back in 2018, she created a pamphlet for other disabled students so that they too could experience the city the same way she did.
I very much focused on different theaters and how they were accessible for me. As a man and wheelchair user, I described a little bit of how public transportation is accessible, so like the bus versus the tube, which is the equivalent of the subway. And so I learned a lot about access in a particularly old city, because there's a lot of steps, there's a lot of cobblestone and things. And so what I learned about was really that even though access doesn't look the same, it doesn't mean that it's not there.
Although Johileny now advocates for the disabled community when it comes to travel, she is also a well-rounded leader who pays it forward for others with disabilities.
I'm actually a mentor for a new organization that's called Disability Empower Network. And I mentor a young girl with a disability. Last year, I worked on a project with a different nonprofit organization to fundraise for a young disabled kid in Dominican Republic. The funds that we were able to raise got him a wheelchair, also got him a tablet and additional like educational games to keep him encouraged and engaged.
So do you have any advice for people like myself that that have body limitations and their body is constantly reminding you have to slow down a bit?
The important part is to really focus on what you can do and how others in your community can support you to reach your goals.
For Latinas, I'm Ashley Castillo.
And that's our show for today. For more information on what you just saw, check out our website at tv.cuny.edu and follow our social media profiles, because we love sharing our Latina stories with you. And please make sure you tune in next month. We'll talk even more about reproductive rights, meet fashionista Agatha Ruiz de la Prada, and so much more. ¡Uepa! ¡Hasta la próxima! Bye-bye.